photovoltaic production. Special thanks to the Allegheny Intermediate Unit 3, the Center for Creativity, funded by the Grable Foundation. Thank you. The purpose of this project was to build photovoltaic modules, find the most efficient means which the students could build them. We used both polycrystalline and monocrystalline cells and various means of encapsulation. The following videos will show you how we did. Thank you. I'm getting ready to solder polycrystalline PV cells. You can see the stuff that I have out. I have a little bit of solder, a soldering pad to keep the tip tin on the soldering iron. I'm using a decent Weller soldering iron with a temperature adjustment. I have a piece of glass underneath the cell to act as a heat sink. I have pre-cut tabbing wire, and I fluxed the tabbing wire before I started soldering so I could just move right along. It's real important to flux the side of the tabbing wire that's going to be touching the cell. It's also important to flux the bus on that's actually the front of the cell, which is the negative side, so the solder will flow and stick to both. It works if you flux just one side, but it doesn't work as well. As you can see, what I'm doing right now is I'm soldering on the second tabbing wire, and it takes about a minute and 40 seconds for me to do this one cell. So it would take, we need 36 cells per module, so take me about an hour and 15 minutes to get them all done. That's it. Do that 35 more times and you'll be set.
First, I cleaned the soldering iron off using a sponge and water. Then I added flux to one side of the tabbing wire and to the front of the solar cell. Once the solder melted and the tabbing wire started to stick, I dragged the soldering iron down so the whole tabbing wire was stuck.
Once the individual cells are soldered, they then need put together, which we call stranding.
We had to tab together 9 polycrystalline cells. Right here, Cannon's doing the same thing. He's cutting the tabs off of the wires. We had to make them mostly flat so that they could, when they were encapsulated, they would seal correctly. Tabbing all these together, we had to make sure that they're in a series to complete the circuit. Positive to negative, negative to positive.
All our cells together. Each cell needs to be connected, positive to negative. Positive side being the back side, as you saw there. Negative side being the front. The wire, small thick wire, that you will use to connect all the ends of the strands together. You're just making sure the wires are all stable so you can dust.
Once all the cells are stranded together, connected positive to negative, the wire coming from the front, which is the negative, to the back, which is the positive, which you can see here, once that is completed, you have to make sure that you have the strands, the group of 9 cells apiece, with a positive wire sticking out on one end of the module, and a negative wire sticking out on the other end of the module. So whenever you go get it all done, you'll have 4 wires sticking out. You can see a bus wire that we have the 2 individual center strands hooked up together. Then we would connect our leads to our output connections on the back of the module.
It's safe to think of the children and imagine the world that we will live. It's probably made with weirdos.
Here's whenever we were building the tables to encapsulate the cells. If we didn't get these tables made to encapsulate the cells, there'd be air pockets in the cells underneath the encapsulation. There'd be water vapors that got inside of there, and that wouldn't be good for the cells. They wouldn't work as long. Here's whenever we were drilling the holes to make sure that we can get the table steady. And in one sec, here's whenever we were making the vibrator for the table so that we can get the table to vibrate and move the encapsulation around.
In order to make our solar panels, we had to use aluminum frames. Here a student is laying out the notches.
The angles are being measured for the frames, right here. And then the student goes over to the bandsaw. That's specifically for metal cutting, and he's going to cut this at a 45-degree angle. And then, after he's done cutting this at a 45-degree angle, we take the frame and we start building it together.
Steve's cutting the side of the frame into a 45-degree angle. Once he's done cutting it at a 45-degree angle, we're going to bend it to a 90.
We used a piece of wood to fit into the frame. Then we made sure the side of the frame folds over top the bottom to keep the water out.
One of the frames we had TIG welded together.
Once the vibrating tables and the frames were completed, we were ready to encapsulate. Here, the students are applying ML solar encapsulation to the back of the cells. You can see the frames are completed, the cells are soldered, and all the connections are made.
Solder the whole panel so that no moisture or air or anything else gets back into the cell. Power, we can lose power from any air getting around in there. So they make sure every part of the cell is underneath and above is covered with this stuff. And once it dries, it's locking in place.
Right here, we're just looking underneath the cells to make sure we got all the air bubbles up.
That is an easy cast. We're going to pour the easy cast to the Gatorade bottle up to the yellow line. Inside the small container is the catalyst. We're going to pour 50 drops of the catalyst into the easy cast. We're going to mix it together.
Now that we've mixed it together for approximately 5 minutes, we are going to pour it all over the panel so that we can spread it around with the paintbrush so that the whole thing is safe from all the weather.
Now that we're done pouring it all over the panel, we're going to use the paintbrushes to brush over it.
Covered with the mixture, we're going to use a wood block to push on the cells to put the mixture underneath the cells to cover up the air bubbles, as you can see.
This is our teacher pushing down the cells and pushing out all of the air bubbles.
Here I'm mixing ML solar encapsulant to pour over the cells. We found this brand to produce the least amount of air bubbles.
You can see on the backs of the cells, there's a few rectangles. Those are steel blocks that we're using to push the cells down flat. That's where they were warped up a little bit. I'm never gonna look back. Whoa, I'm never gonna give it up. No,
second layer of MLA encapsulation because their cells were warped and they were heated too high. And we have to fill in all the air bubbles between the glass and the cells.
Right here, we're looking underneath the glass, looking at the front of the module. You can see a couple small air bubbles through the encapsulation that didn't get in between the glass and the cells. It's very important that all the air is out.
Okay, so this is where we did one of our first tests to see if the EVA would work. So we did the glass, EVA, the cells, another piece of EVA, and the TPE. And we used a vacuum to suck out any of the air between the two pieces of EVA so that there would be no bubbles in between it. And then once we put the vacuum in, we had to tape it off. Another one of our tests. We did the EVA, the cells, EVA, and then the glass. We used a flash dryer to see if it worked. And then we also used a heat gun because the EVA needs to get to about 290 degrees to melt properly. Here's another test where we put the cells face down. We did the glass, EVA, cells, and the EVA. We used a vacuum to suck out any of the air. And we used a heat gun, but you got to make sure you heat away from the vacuum first so that it properly vacuums and gets all the air bubbles out. Okay, so this was one of our real first panels we actually did. We taped off all the edges, and then we used the vacuum, of course, to suck down any of the air. We used a heat gun, and we just did different sections every day. And you can see it's working well, because you can see the tapping water. This is way more efficient than the heat gun. We used the light bulbs to cook the EVA evenly. Okay, first we heat the EVA underneath of our homemade easy bake oven. And we cook that for about 15 minutes until all the bubbles are completely out. This is when we put our light bulb contraction to the test. We heated the cells face up and we put wax paper behind it. So when we were done heating it, we could peel it off and it would be all complete. So this is where, after we were done heating, we realized that there were still some air bubbles. So we had to heat the EVA and then use something small like a razor to push all the air out of the bubbles so that it would be nice and flat.
Once the modules were encapsulated, we were ready to build the rack, which we were going to set them on top of the roof.
After grinding all extra weld off, I'm bolting all the frame pieces onto the places where they was drawn to scale to go. We use wood carriage bolts to connect 90% of the unit struts and piece the angled parts together with L brackets. The frame is cut to a 40-degree angle to hold the panels in place on a sunny slope area so the sun hits longer.
We had to attach caddy pyramids on the bottom in order to keep it level and stay off of any dry or wet surface ground.
Once the caddy pyramid was on, we flipped the frame over, and it was all finished to go on top of the roof.
Here we are scraping off cells that did not properly adhere to the glass. The encapsulation process was not successful. There was too many air pockets in it, so we decided that we wanted to salvage the glass instead of throwing away the whole entire panel and having to buy a new piece of glass. This is better for us because we don't have to spend money on new glass. It's still usable, but we had to scrape off all the cells,